We have our next speaker, Pratap Vardhan. He's a data scientist and a product engineer at Graminer. He's an enthusiast, advocate, and an open data. Open data and a mapper, contributing regularly to OpenStreetMap. He's currently working on flood simulations using OSM data and DEM, and is here at State of the Map Asia to give us an idea about the same.
It's a visualization of what we call as elevation models. Each data point here is a representation of the height of that space. What do you think left represents, and what do you think the right represents? Which city? Right. Do you know why you were able to say that? I mean, what was the initial visual cue that got that answer? Shape. Can you give me an answer for this city? So on the right, you see it's more like the height of the city at different points, right? You'd also notice there's a small river that's crossing horizontally. I'll give you another guess. This city or a state capital is probably going to election in next 2 months. Yeah. So this is Hyderabad. But let me begin with what are DEMs and what do they do? These are our machine deployed mappers working in space. They're collecting information of how much height each grid of planet is, and they store that information in form of images. You could download these from different providers, and you have different providers. I'll talk that in brief. But essentially, it's a representation of each height as a pixel. Higher the value, it represents that the height is much higher. And then you'll be able to map this information to look at where are the rivers, where are the mountains, where are the oceans, where are the ponds. There are certain satellite missions which are recording this information on a time-lapse basis. You could also see if there has been any degradation of soil or movement of certain settlements. But for my talk, I mostly use information from the NASA Earth Explorer, where you get DEM information. And there's ISRO also has a Bhuvan platform where they do give this information, but I did try it out for Chennai. It was not that great, so I reverted to NASA. These are the two interfaces that you would have to work with. The interfaces are not so clean. You might have to spend some time Google some YouTube videos where you can how to toggle through different navigation systems and get here. Click on a tile, you get a representation of it, download it. You get a TIFF image. TIFF has different properties. It also talks about what are the latlongs that you can use as bounding if you want to overlay stuff, and you can begin with that. This is the Bhuvan interface. But in short, if you were to construct your own dummy model, like how it may look like, create a small Excel file, which may look like a cross grid, and assuming the ocean is at 0 meters level, that is what you see on the right side. And then slowly, there's a small elevation. That's when the first pixel with pixel numbered as 1, then you have 2, then you have 3, and then you will have 4 and so on. So if you notice, most of our terrains are not always constantly increasing. After the coast, if it's there in Western Ghats or Eastern Ghats, you have small ridges, then the ridge will stop, the mountain or the hill will stop, then maybe there'll be certain settlements or cities. Now, whenever there is, let's say, ocean flooding happens, or let's say the climate rises and the water levels or ocean levels increase, it's not that you can simply apply a filter that says if ocean levels are 3 meters high, and if I were to apply a filter that says, show me the areas where it is 3 meters, are these affected? Not necessarily, because if there is a mountain in front of me which covers me or encloses me, I may not be affected, but I may get affected if the water keeps spreading after a period of time. So we'll try and focus in this talk what are the algorithms that you can use, how you can use certain open source libraries to build it. Bulk of the work that we will be talking today will be opened up on GitHub as a notebook, and you could just play around with different cities of your interest. Why is it really important for us to simulate floods? How does it help us? So one thing, like recently when I think there were certain floods in Kerala and also before due to rainfall in Chennai, people were able to map stuff on reported flooding. But that helps in post-preparedness, I mean, where you have to act. What would you do if you know upfront under certain control parameters or control situations, which are the areas that may get affected first? Or on day 1, this is a place that may get affected. On day 2, this might be the place that might get affected. There are a couple of things that you could do. You can maybe manage your resources better. You can always have a plan for on the third or fifth day, I'll have these camping locations where I can mobilize people and pick them up from there. Or people interested making money out of this can have different insurance premiums for different locations when if they're securing their properties based on the risk that may be avoided with oceans. The simple math that goes into predicting how the flood might flow is something that you see here. On the top, what you see is the DEM model, which is essentially a representation of what the height of each grid is. And when you see n equal to 1, and when height is 0, the ocean levels are still the same. Initially, the coastline gets affected. The next image, what you see is this is the second iteration, but the height hasn't changed. When there's no speed or there's no height difference, there's not much of flooding. It's still the same stuff that we see every day. But the moment there's a 1 meter rise in the ocean levels, the immediate next iteration of first immediate cells get affected first. Post that, when the height becomes 2 and the next iteration, so the spread is always one grid apart. You don't jump two grids in front. Immediately, it's the next quarter that gets filled. So you'll notice there is a valley which is more like meter 3, and they are not getting affected first. But after the height increases, they get immediately affected. So there is a high probability that you may be lying in region with pixels 1, and there are pixels located as 2. They may get affected first, even before you do. So it depends on what are you surrounded with and what might affect you, and also the direction of the flow. The water may be coming at 45 degrees, not necessarily 90 degrees. Most of the simulation softwares assume certain parameters, but you don't necessarily have these controls how to play around with them. So these could be mostly to do with speed, the height at which the ocean is increasing, or the direction at which it's happening. Soil sometimes may have certain absorption levels. There might be drain systems in between which might be pushing water out. There are different parameters that you can model and control them. So let's try this out. I've done this for Chennai for now, and then we can expand this for more stuff. So this is Chennai elevation map. This represents different height. You do see certain yellow spots which are at a higher elevation. That is mostly the region. I'll probably come back later and show you what are those regions, but you get a sense that there are spots which are at a higher altitude, but there are also certain small puddles or lakes which are at a zero level or almost less than 10 meter level. We begin with an initial assumption that the ocean levels are already at 2 meters, and then there is a uniform spread of water at 360 degree directions, which means that water is spreading in all directions at the same amount of speed. What we see now is at different cycles, you almost see nothing is happening initially, although the height is increasing. Slowly you'll start noticing at the bottom, the stretch has increased. And then in the middle, there's a stretch that has increased. But what's interesting to note, on the right side, on the top left, you see initially there's not much spread. There's a small opening that results in a complete swamp there. It completely floods the region afterwards. Now this, you will not understand if you just look at the map in isolation, because you don't know what's underneath or what's affecting it. Once you start overlaying, let's say like OSM maps with some zooming features, you notice there's almost an empty land there. And then once you zoom in and notice that, there's actually a petroleum manufacturing unit there, which is effectively plowed over that region. And it might be even dangerous, because once the petroleum factory is not evacuated or shut off immediately, these plants may even explode faster, right? And you would notice on the right side, on the left side at the bottom, there's a high chance that people would be much safer if they go and stay in the park, the Gundi Park, the national park. That's probably at an elevation. Even though the water surrounds, those are the regions that may be less affected at initial, let's say, 5 days at a certain speed of ocean currents. Now, this may help you to plan things better, maybe plan your evacuation or airlifting programs much better if you knew how could you simulate when a tsunami happens, a potential tsunami at a certain earthquake levels, at a certain direction. This may help you with that. But you also do need to have controls over what may be the regions that may get affected first, or what may be the regions that may get affected last, or what might be the intensity. Using these algorithms and overlaying stuff, we would be able to say that initially it could be that the coastal, that's the Marina Reach and the Adyar region gets completely flooded first. And then by the time initially the gate over the Parktown gets exposed, the Georgetown is still safe. But once the Parktown gets exposed, the complete upper left channels gets completely swept away because that's mostly a flat region probably created because there's a refinery over there. And that impacts after that. So Annanagar is most likely to get flooded first than Kodambakkam. But if we are not aware of this information, you'll start attacking all regions with equal response systems, but that may not be necessary. This is a different representation of the same thing. These are different risk levels that might be associated with different regions. So you notice that the park region is not affected yet. And there are beach regions that have high intensity, that's obvious. But Georgetown, even though that is still closer to the beach, is probably not affected because it's a higher elevation and there are no channels that are opening yet. Would it be possible for people to actually build something around Parktown or maybe some drainage systems that may expose the water back to different regions so that the refinery doesn't get affected? That could be one option. Let me also show you how this may look like. So once you overlay any animations, could be a GIF or could be video files, could be even streaming video files, you could just use OSM tiles. And then would be able to see which are the regions that are getting affected. So people from IIT are much better off being with the animals than being in their hostels. So there are certain assumptions that were made here. The flow of water is unilaterally same in all directions. It increases at a certain rate. And we are not considering the factors like does water evaporate or the ocean levels stop at a certain point. Those could be also be factored in and then you can tweak this simulation altogether. But this gives you a glimpse of it's not same always. It's not necessary that if you're closer to the coast, the other person may get affected first. It depends where you reside, what's your neighboring region, and how does this flow come in. There's a brief simulation also comparing different control parameters. If ocean levels start at different heights with different speeds and with different directions, so this is how it may look, assuming at different heights. The first one, you would actually see that the speed is twice the speed horizontally than vertically. And the bottom two have similar speeds of ocean growth. And so if you notice almost for, let's say for 30 epochs or even 100 epochs, the first one doesn't really affect anything. But for the second and third, the areas below Georgetown's get affected much faster. And there's a tipping point after 140 or 150, after those cycles, and the flood, the rate at which the flood grows, or because of the capacity it's holding, it completely flooders the entire region afterwards. So there's no point probably even evacuating. If you have any evacuation chance, it's probably in the first 100 epochs that you can even try, right? So the next use case that I just took up and saw what might happen if, let's take Mumbai for example, and people are talking about if there's a 2 degree increase in temperatures, there's a potential 20 feet increase in the ocean levels. What might happen if 10 meters of ocean levels water increase in Mumbai? Which are the regions do you think are most likely to get affected? Before I show those, you have any guesses like what might be the areas that might have huge impact in terms of collateral damage, people, area?
Mine.
That comes under South Mumbai. I'm bad with
South Mumbai. South,
okay. Anything else? Okay. Dharavis. Okay. You're guessing. Fine. Any people from New Mumbai? The expansion areas. Okay. So 10 meters will effectively clean up the regions that are there in these locations. Mahol is pretty much safe, but in Wadala regions where you have in front of Wadala, the Antop Hill where you see a lot of mangroves, those get washed off. But even before that, the receding levels are much higher up. It goes much deeper. The depth of or the high elevations of those land regions are much at a much lower level. So for example, Wadala Road and Antop Hill may not get affected, but these regions will. Similarly, that's the case with the other image that you see over there. If you go a little more deeper into Mumbai, and then you would see you have these places, that's essentially the Navi Mumbai area and all, right? Reliance is probably safe. They don't have to move their corporate headquarters or wherever they're doing their stuff. They're pretty much safe there. But all of the places that surrounded there gets affected. The places that will badly get affected is not necessarily Mumbai, but that is the one that is below the Navi Mumbai coach where it has an enclosure. Those places will get flooded at a much faster rate, and the population densities are also at a decent levels. But with our, we focus too much on Mumbai that we forget that what are the places that are surrounded there, those migrant populations which usually grow there or densities are much higher there. So with this, I'll pause on the use cases that we tried this week. But why are we doing this? What's the point of this? This probably gives you a chance to build your own tools. These algorithms are pretty simple. I didn't dive into how this algorithm underneath works, but if you're interested, we can spend some time on it. I'll probably open this up over this weekend, and you guys can contribute, add more examples, different parameters, and then so on. As far as tools are concerned, most of it was built on top of Python. We used GDAL to extract information, stitch images with tiles together. We use NumPy and OpenCV for image processing. We've used Leaflet, but used a package called Folium, which does the stuff that we need. All that you have seen is just creation of a video or a GIF, overlaying that on Leaflet maps, recording it, and then pushing it out. You can do even fancy stuff that give the user the control. You use some sliders and stuff. Let them decide what might be the height, what might be the areas. Then you can probably even do it for the entire coastline of India. Because these maps are pretty heavy. So each, the Chennai region that we just took, that's probably less than half a degree of dimensions. That image is probably 1 MB of worth. But you could do it. In a day's time, you can do it for the entire coastline. The notebook that I'll be publishing would be IPython notebook, or call as Jupyter notebook now. And much of the plotting also comes from Matplotlib. The only two data sources we've used is OSM and DEM data. The links are shared in the slide. That apart, any questions so far? Anything you'd like to know? Do let me know. Otherwise, meet me at lunch. Thanks.